native Stanson's native sons. Rocco was a gunner who loved the howl of gunfire and the squeal of the electric guitar. Skeeter was a cannon man who was fond of the thick tone of the bass. Archie, the tormented soul of the group, for it was his job to search for enemy landmines using complex items such as golf clubs and shoehorns, played the drums. The plans they had excited them beyond their wildest dreams. They were going to be stars when the fires came. The straw hut they resided in was no match for the raging inferno. All three were left alive, charred and bitter. Upon their return, their dreams shifted. No more did they want to be stars. They wanted to wreak havoc on the ears of those who didn't sacrifice themselves. They bitterly named the band the Buddha's Gouda, for the enemy's general was named Buddha, and he ordered all of his servants to fetch him the world's best Gouda, trampling anything that got in the way. And so it was all decided. They were mercenaries against society. They filled all of their amps with toilet paper and mothballs, and they ran over all of their percussion equipment with their Humvee, the only thing the army would let them keep. Their tunes consisted of cackling out-of-tune guitar riffs, bellowing mournful bass notes, and the clacking pattern of drums. They played the tunes of the blind and the dead, howling war stories and shrieks of pain and agony that could only have been derived from the dark, from the light. both shared a curiosity for the things around us, whether it be sights, smells, or sounds. We were equals. We also shared the role of being steady figures in dysfunctional households. My aunt and uncle both worked for large, big city chemical companies. Rarely were they ever home, leaving Nolan to his own devices. You could usually find him peering out the large window looking into his backyard. He would take the big notepad I got him for Christmas one year, a pen, and a large glass of chocolate milk, and sit and draw for hours on end to whatever he saw in the backyard. Once a week, our great uncle Purvis would come over and drink fat whiskeys and tell Nolan stories, as he did with all of us when we were young. Most of the time, his storytelling consisted of anti-aging spiels and drunken muttering about his time in the Merchant Marine. One day, though, he came to the house drunk and disgruntled, yelling loudly and throwing everything around in sight at the wall, sending Nolan scurrying out of the house. Nolan knew not to walk toward his cousin's house, for the entire family warned him of the harm that would cause. So he started walking for miles and miles, hours and hours. It wasn't until he reached the edge of a marsh did he stop to rest. He'd lie down on the bank and close his eyes. He breathed in the thick marsh air and listened to the herons sing. All of a sudden, it clicked for him, and he began to cry joyfully. He ran dead speed back to his house, ran through the door, avoiding Uncle Purvis, and went up into his room and wrote on his notepad. He imagined to himself, what if everyone lived in the marsh and not near the Buddha's Gula? He fell softly asleep and dreamed of returning to the marsh